My name is Julia Mahoney. I am the Education Program Administrator for Renew Theaters. I want to welcome our members of the Ambler, the County, the Princeton Garden, and the Highway, as well as members from the Majestic in Gettysburg, which is partnering with us this fall. And I want to thank the VESTA Fund, which has provided us an additional grant to expand the series and to bring in other theaters and more speakers, and a larger variety of programs as well. So we're continuing with our classic film series, but we've added other programs to Deep Focus. These include Wes on Wednesdays, which is about to happen, the Middle Eastern Cinema Series, and an Asian American film series. So tonight we will be discussing The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, but I also wanted to mention that we have an upcoming event next Monday, October 25th, in our Asian American film series on the director Justin Chong, two of his films, Gook and Blue Bayou. You can find more information about past and upcoming talks at our website, deepfocus.film. Before I turn things over to Ian, just a quick reminder of Zoom and question protocols. So I do request that everybody remain on mute unless speaking. We will start with a talk led by Ian and then open it up to discussion. We ask that if you have a question or comment, please use the raised hand feature, which is found in the menu at the bottom of your screen, and I will call on speakers, but as the conversation goes on, since we are a more intimate group, you know, we can all talk to each other as well. And you're also welcome to use the chat feature. So often there are little side conversations going on in the chat feature that we can bring together, especially during the Q&A portion of the evening. Our speaker for tonight is Professor Ian Fleishman from the University of Pennsylvania. Ian is an associate professor of German and Cinema and Media Studies. He holds a doctorate in French and German literature from Harvard and has published on subjects ranging from the Baroque to contemporary cinema and moving image pornography. In addition to his talk tonight on The Life Aquatic, he kicked our West on Wednesday series off just a month ago on the Royal Tannenbaums, and we are very happy to have him back.
Thanks, Julia. Thanks to everybody for being here and for having me. And including me in this conversation, it's been a fun experience to get to revisit some Wes Anderson films. As I said, when kicking off the series, introducing the Royal Tenenbaums, I kind of enjoyed picking this pairing because we have one film which is a sort of unprecedented success. The Royal Tenenbaums is where Wes Anderson's career really takes off. And then one film which comes out a few years later, The Life Aquatic, which at least at the time of its release is a sort of commercial flop, and is critically panned as well. So I was interested in that sort of evolving celebrity and evolving notion of Wes Anderson as an American auteur and what that pairing of films might reveal. So I will refer to The Royal Tenenbaums as well in our discussion tonight. Seeing that this is a film that is explicitly about filmmaking and is about the sort of imaginary that accompanies filmmaking, in a lot of ways, it's Wes Anderson as at his most meta, and Wes Anderson tends to be fairly meta. But I was wondering to myself what we make of the fact that Anderson treats this film, on the one hand, as a work of juvenilia and of exploration, and on the other, he takes as his subject a directorial double in Bill Murray's Steve Zissou, who's incarnated in a sort of washed up has-been, a celebrity filmmaker whose career is now waning precisely at the moment when Wes Anderson's career seems to be so, you know, precipitously on the rise. I'm interested in this question in part because I think it inflects our understanding of the film as initially, as I said, a flop that then turns over time into a cult classic. And I am going to share my screen with you because I have some quotations from Anderson and others. Can everybody see that all right? So Anderson sums this up. He says, at the time of the release, a friend was talking about the film and says, you know, it's going to take people a while to understand this. And this is what he has to say on that. I remember a friend said it's going to be 10 years before people appreciate The Life Aquatic. And she's kind of right. They did a screening of it in New York recently, and it was a great night. Like the Royal Tenenbaums, we opened it at the New York Film Festival, and it was fine. But we screened it again 10 years later, and I was like, where were these people 10 years ago? It was the exact same room, but a completely different experience. So I wouldn't mind only seeing my movies 10 years after they come out. That is a luxury of, I say, a successful career that we should all aspire to. In a sense, then, Anderson in this movie, again, is every bit as precocious as his childhood turned adulthood characters in The Royal Tenenbaums. And as I said, I'll remain attentive to this parallel throughout. Last time, I drew a lot on the work of Whitney Crowther's Dilly, who sums up the sort of role of The Life Aquatic pretty well, I think. The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou was originally condemned as a massive critical and commercial failure, with scathingly critical reviews accusing Anderson of self-parody. I'm interested in that first sentence in part because it seems to sell or present as Anderson's failure with this film that it's just a bit too Wes Anderson. That right after he's become recognizable as a sort of auteur brand with the Royal Tenenbaums, this one's a bit too much on brand, and that's what people are having trouble with. So picking up where we left off. Over time, however, the film has experienced its own kind of redemption, and it's now recognized as a film of surprising depth. A midlife crisis film about failure, legacy, and death made by a filmmaker just in his early 30s. It's clear that Anderson's film releases are out of step with their time, and his films are possibly ahead of their time. So again, here's Wes Anderson, still a young filmmaker, but precocious enough to make a film in his early 30s, right as his career is taking off, about what will it be like when my career wanes and I no longer have the artistic prowess that I once did. That this film has had legs, you know, staying power despite its initial, let's call it unsuccess at the box office, is testified to by the wealth of scholarship that surrounds it. I thought that at a colloquium at noon today, and I thought after that, oh, surely that'll be enough time this afternoon to read all of the scholarship that's available on The Life Aquatic. Not even close. There is our essay upon article upon article on this. In some of the volumes that are dedicated to Wes Anderson, and I'll cite from these a little bit later, this is the only film that gets two essays that are thoroughly dedicated to it. So among those who are thinking carefully about Wes Anderson, or among those who enjoy Wes Anderson, this film, despite being a sort of, you know, B-side of the oeuvre, seems to hold a special place. I should also say this is commented on in the commentary on the Criterion DVD. Introducing it, Wes Anderson points out that this is the first DVD release of the film. I haven't fact-checked him, so I'm not sure that he's right, but in which case the film doesn't actually get a home distribution until it is already being anthologized by Criterion. You know, these are the people who decide, the Academy that decides, you know, what are the world film classics. And that's the first time that it comes out in a double DVD package with so many features that you could really spend a lifetime just exploring the different features on the two DVDs there. So I would definitely recommend that to anybody who's interested. But so just to sum up, we'll go through the sort of three questions at once. This film is, as you know, sort of meta. On the one hand, this film as a work of relative juvenilia. On the other, then I'll conclude with some thoughts on the question of celebrity, particularly as it attaches not only to Wes Anderson as, you know, a growing, an increasingly household name when it comes to filmmaking, but also as it attaches to Bill Murray, who is more important for this film even than I would say most actors incarnating a title role. So to start with the question of the sort of self-reflexivity of the film, this film within a film. Like The Royal Tenenbaums and other of Anderson's films, this one is introduced in part through a series of framing devices, notably the film festival, where the first half of the two-part Jaguar Shark film is being presented. Anderson talks about the central idea of this film as being about the luck of getting to make films, and the family and community, and that's the note that I'll end on, that comes together in the making of a film. Notably, as Laura Shackelford points out, it also returns to the frame in the end in an even more radical manner, which makes it kind of difficult. And I think here's more so in, than in the case of the Tenenbaums adaptation of a fictive novel, to tell whether we are still within a film at the end or not. So summarizing some previous scholarly perspectives and adding a new twist, Shackelford puts that well. Confounding our ability to stabilize the boundary between the film's inside and outside, The Life Aquatic reconceives filmic world building as an ongoing process. We might even claim that there is no final frame to the film that securely ends its world building. So no final shot in the film that says, you know, we're done, now go back to your lives. Critics such as Mark Browning suggest that the film comes full circle, opening and closing with a premiere at the Loquato Film Festival. Yet close attention to The Life Aquatic's final scene featuring Team Ziso along the seaside, including the now deceased Ned, so he's resurrected for this final moment, reveals that we're watching a pre-recorded scene from the conclusion of Ziso's documentary film, not the end to Anderson's film, which paradoxically relocates The Life Aquatic within Ziso's documentary. So if The Royal Tenenbaums is supposed to be based on a book that we know doesn't exist, but is sort of loosely modeled on J.D. Salinger, this one, according to Shackelford, doesn't quite close up as neatly. I'd be interested in hearing your thoughts on this during the discussion afterwards, because it's not entirely clear to me whether we're being relocated within, you know, one of the documentaries, or if this is just a complete sort of dream sequence. You know, it's the characters coming out for a sort of another round. They're taking their bows in the same way that characters are often introduced individually in Wes Anderson films. You see that here, and you see that also in The Life Aquatic, of course, in The Royal Tenenbaums, of course. Donna Kornhaver's read the entirety of Anderson's work through the lens of the collector. And I think perhaps the most meta moment in this film is the dollhouse sequence, where we're introduced to the various spaces of the ship in a sort of cross section. And that cross section, although there was a real ship that they acquired in North Africa and you know, sailed up the Mediterranean, but that cross section of the ship revealing it to be a construction is repeated at a couple of key points throughout the movie and presents it as if it were a sort of cabinet of curiosities, which is not unlike the Harlem Mansion that we have, for instance, in The Royal Tenenbaums. This is an adventure, is the final line of the film and the DVD commentary. Noah Baumbach, who co-wrote the script with Wes Anderson, and Wes Anderson sort of give up on explicating it. They're afraid that it's going to sound a little bit trite if they go into detail on what that would mean. But having no such fears myself of being trite, I wanted to point out that this is a film about exploration, and not only on this sort of obvious thematic level that it's a film about sea exploration, but it is also a film about exploring different ways of filmmaking. It was started already when Wes Anderson was in college and wrote up a treatment on Jacques Cousteau, which he continued to work on here and there for about 15 years before Owen Wilson finally convinced him, persuaded him that you need to make this into a movie, so, you know, finish up the damn script, and he did. Now, the character was initially named Steve Cousteau after the maritime explorer and filmmaker whom you see here with his iconic red hat, well, iconic at least from this film, who had, and I think this is important for Anderson's interest, thinking forward to the French Dispatch, worked with the French resistance during World War II, among other, you know, memorable moments of Cousteau's life. The French Dispatch was apparently originally billed, Julia, you might know this better, but as a musical set in post-war France. I didn't know that. The caveat, the dedication at the end, you might remember that the final sort of moment of the film is that it's dedicated to Jacques Cousteau, but then there's a distancing from the Cousteau Society, was at their bidding. They wanted to sort of disavow the film. Cousteau's name is curiously bleeped out of the DVD commentary, So every time it comes up, you hear a bleep as if they were swearing. I don't know if that is a legal thing or if it's a joke. I suspect that it's a sort of in joke about that. We all know whom we're talking about. But Cousteau's, society didn't want any credit or didn't want any association with this film. Importantly, in that commentary, Noah Baumbach also compares Cousteau to Bill Murray. He says that both of these figures are, and were especially for Wes Anderson and Noah Baumbach as children, what he calls a star incarnate. And I think just as importantly, he says that this is a kid's idea of what an adult is. So with Cousteau, that's obvious. You get to go off exploring and diving underwater and seeing new things and creatures. And with Bill Murray, it's a bit more complicated, but I am eager to sort of think through together what it means to look at Bill Murray as a child's idea of what an adult might be. And both Wes Anderson and Noah Baumbach say in the commentary that Bill Murray is as much of an influence on the character as Bleep here himself. Alongside Cousteau, just sort of anticipating the French connection that we'll be seeing in this next film, there is the evocation of Jules Verne, specifically Captain Nemo from 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, who is sort of evoked here obscurely alongside, Captain Ahab from Melville's Moby Dick as a literary precedent. Another moment in which the film is a sort of, meta. But Wes Anderson, as we're about to see in conversation with Jeff Goldblum, for Anderson, it was also a learning experience as a director. And he was working abroad for the first time and with all sorts of new possibilities and constraints. It's a sort of ill-advised project from the get-go, and he's aware of that. Or to phrase it with Sisu in his final line, this is an adventure. And just for context, so you know that I'm not exaggerating, at $50 million, this film cost twice as much to make as The Royal Tenenbaums. I mean, you've got all of this stop action, you've got a lot of effects, you've got a lot of actors, you've got a lot of travel. It's a big budget film. And at $34 million at the box office, it raked in just about half of what The Royal Tenenbaums did. So especially coming at a moment when Wes Anderson is suddenly a marketable name and a potentially profitable name, this does end up being a flop. But I'm gonna play a clip, this is about 5 minutes of the different actors and Anderson discussing the difficulties in making this film and some of the issues that possibly could have been avoided. But also discussing the film as a learning experience. So do stop me if for some reason this isn't playing well, and I'll send you to the YouTube clip instead.
Everybody tells you, don't do it. Don't go sure. Film this movie on boats and things. Really? Do a different sort of story. And they're right, it turns out.
What's that goofy town on the water? We're in Naples. We had to go offshore on Naples. We had to be in the harbor and shoot on the boat at night. And it was really cold.
Anything at night, we would have done on a set. You know, we went out, we were out on these boats in the middle of the night in pitch black. There's no benefit to that.
Okay, why don't we shoot, what's his name, Sao George, singing songs inside in the heated boat until 3 o'clock in the morning. And then we'll shoot Bill outside in the water when it was 19 degrees. I got a bone chill so bad that Angelica came in and was rubbing my body, trying to keep my blood moving. They were covering me with cashmeres and all these kinds of crazy things they were getting from town. My bones got so cold, they were cold for months afterwards.
And also we just didn't, what we didn't do was the round of things where you say, what's gonna really happen?
The first day we got in the water, and the water was cold.
Outside of Tonsa?
Wherever the hell we were in the tank.
Oh, in the tank, yeah.
We were in the tank. The first day the water was cold, like 54. They basically got it out of a fire hydrant, came right into the water. It was 54. And we would come out of the water after about the first take, the first session down there, we were in there for about 40 minutes, something like that. We came out up on the water, and they had big, like, fireman's hoses of hot water that they would they poured on us. Do you remember that?
I remember that.
And they poured the hot water on us. Says, okay, then go back in. Well, the next time we were only able to stay in there about 20 minutes.
I do.
And then we came out again. They poured us the hot water, and they had to pour us even longer. And then the next time we were only in there for 10 minutes. And then we came out, and they were pouring us with hot water, and everyone was like.
This pirate attack we did in the movie, we, you know, I think we scheduled 4 days to shoot this thing. Well, this wasn't a realistic schedule for something
so
to be shot.
So you know more about all that now and how to anticipate, and that's just.
And I remember one day where it was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I said, hey, we're not going to get a shot today. We're not going to roll this camera, are we? I mean, we had reached this very late moment of the day, and all we could do was make boats continue to not get in line with each other, smoke boat in the wrong place in relation to the pirate boat and the other boat, and then suddenly we're ready to go, but we realize there's land, you know, we've the whole thing is spun around, and now we're facing the wrong direction, and we're looking right at Italy.
And how you must have been, that must be.
That's not a good feeling.
Upsetting. No.
So then they had to figure out how to heat the water. And they heated the water, but they didn't know how to heat the water without making little tiny bubbles. So it was like badois.
Wow, I'm remembering this now.
Yeah, so then there was bubbles in the water. So we went down in the water and we're shooting in the water. Bloop, bloop, and you couldn't see anybody. It was like there was a fog in the water because they'd boiled the water or something and there were bubbles and everything. Then they had to go find a guy who knew how to heat water without getting bubbles in it.
The plans weren't working. And you know, as a result of which we went 20 days over schedule. I don't know if you remember that. 20 days is a pretty good hunk. I mean, that's the, you know, that could have been, for all we know, that could have been half a movie, you know. And we went $8 million over budget. Well, these days nobody would let us go $8 million over there. How would we go $8 million over budget? What $8 million?
Is there any shortcut to learning the things that you've learned without having done that? So isn't that a great thing, you know?
I know, I agree. I feel like we made a thing that's, you know, I mean, we did our movie.
Hollywood was a million miles away. It didn't feel like a job. It didn't feel like I was acting. I was getting to be around Bill Murray and just being folded into these scenes and not needing much, just really wanted to be there to be a part of it.
Have you had experiences where you've said, I'm gonna do this differently on the next week. I've just learned this. Do you think of specific things like that? Or is that something that sort of,
I'm a craft geek and I'm always trying to figure out how do you prepare for what, how do you use your time best so that it comes out better? I look at some things that I have done and I go, geez, I'm lucky to have gotten a chance to keep doing it after this. I don't like the way that came out.
That last bit is, there's a lot that's interesting in there. I'll come back to that last bit in a second. One thing throughout those interviews, those discussions that's fun to look at is the different experience that Willem Dafoe and Bill Murray, who have been paired, I think, sort of brilliantly here, just sort of just a funny pairing, those two. You know, Willem Dafoe's so creepy and Bill Murray, so Bill Murray. But Willem Dafoe obviously just so enjoys Bill Murray and says, you know, Hollywood is a million miles away. I'm just here shooting the shit with Bill Murray. We're having so much fun. Bill Murray had an awful time on set by all accounts. He was filming this and Lost in Translation at the same time. So he had to go back and forth between there and Tokyo. As you can see, this was a sort of physically grueling film of the kind that Bill Murray, you know, not an action hero, doesn't tend to do a lot. But so these were the learning experiences. The discussion with Jeff Goldblum at the end, I think, highlights two things. Jeff Goldblum and Bill Murray and, you know, others in these films belong to a particular class of actors. Jeff Goldblum is always, in a sense, playing himself. Any role that he has is a cameo. And there is a certain so bad it's goodness to the quality of acting that you have from somebody like Jeff Goldblum or Bill Murray, and very consciously, self-consciously. So this idea that, you know, a movie as grotesque and over the top as something like The Fly, that nonetheless becomes a sort of masterpiece. And I really like that Wes Anderson is not disavowing this film in any way. He says, no, I made the film that I wanted to make, and it turned out as I wanted to make it. You can sense sort of the tension between him and Noah Baumbach at moments on the DVD commentary, where Noah Baumbach seems sort of tempted to apologize for certain aspects of how artificial, for instance, the special effects are, while at the same time wanting to make sure that he's signaling to Wes Anderson and to the public that he thinks it's perfectly in keeping, but it wouldn't necessarily be his aesthetic. I think that we are all particularly glad that Wes Anderson gets to continue to make movies after this, and does not have the problem that Jeff Goldblum says, you know, like, I saw that, what I did, and I didn't really like it, and I just feel very honored that I get to continue to make movies after this. But considering the financial losses that this film sustained, I think that we can all be very glad that it did not seem to diminish Wes Anderson's celebrity. Also thinking about the relationship to the Royal Tenenbaums, Crawlers-Dilley notes that this film is too about the cult of celebrity, and writes, the creation of the atmosphere of devotion to fictitious people is an Anderson trademark. So fictitious, like the three, you know, prodigy, genius children, or four really, of the Royal Tenenbaums, but also of our Steve Sisu in this film. Is an Anderson trademark, but specifically Anderson likes to create an atmosphere of reverence that is tastefully done, the recognition of elite tastes rather than mere sensationalism. One of the conceits of the Royal Tenenbaums that you just have to grant it is that, for instance, a playwright could become a celebrity in our day and age. There's an attachment to a kind of high culture that permeates Wes Anderson's films. Through his films, Anderson wishes to explore the meaning of fame and success from every angle and in every incarnation. This is the central question in The Life Aquatic, and it is this film that allows Anderson his very personal, and yet perhaps for that reason, his most disjointed exploration of the topic. People like to say, I'm not actually sure what they're referring to at the top of my head, but you know, that there are dropped character arcs, or that there are elements of this film that seem to be important but then don't reappear. That it doesn't seem maybe as tightly put together as other of Anderson's films. And we talked last time about how Wes Anderson sort of relaunched Bill Murray's career after the comedian had a series of commercial flops of his own. And in some ways, the shared authorship and collaborative spirit of the film, to which I'll return at the end, makes it as much a film about Bill Murray's career trajectory as it does about Wes Anderson's career trajectory. As Kennedy Carpot, Colleen Kennedy Carpot, whom I'll quote in a second, points out, Anderson painstakingly crafts his vision down to the tiniest detail, but also leaves room for his actors to improvise within that structure. And Kennedy Carpot summarizes that Bill Murray's loose approach exemplifies this premeditated randomness. I really like that phrase. The idea of a sort of aleatory approach to cinema, where a lot of it is mapped out, but then within those constraints, there is room for improvisation. Murray himself talks about this. I prefer to play a different way each time. I want to get my money's worth. I want it to work out. I want to work out. Before, I felt like I had to be pretty responsible and professional because I don't know how these people work, meaning his co-stars. But then I realized, you know what? They're gonna do it their way no matter what. So I'm just gonna keep doing it my way. That's when I finally just had fun. So this film is a learning experience then for Bill Murray as well. Every take is different. He says this in a different interview. It's fun for me just to go, just to let the lines fly. And there are sort of prominent, examples of that kind of exploration in this film. There's a moment where he points the gun at Cape Blanchett. And Anderson says, I just sort of saw this sort of black thing enter from the corner of the frame and, you know, yelled cut and said, wait, did you just point a gun at a pregnant reporter? And Bill Murray says, yeah. And Wes Anderson goes, that's kind of a nice touch. To which Noah Baumbach in the DVD commentary responds, yeah, it was such a nice touch that I thought we wrote it. he seems to really think that he'd written that in and that it hadn't been improvised. Some of it suggested that Murray's role here is a sort of parodic anti-Anderson, that the sort of, you know, grating, homophobic, egomaniacal filmmaker that Bill Murray incarnates is the anti-Anderson. But I think that there are ways too in which they're similar, and I'll get to those in just a second. Murray, as I noted, had just re-entered the limelight at the point of this film's release, not its making, with Lost in Translation. So this is the great sort of quasi-dramatic role that I think really marks Bill Murray's career and owes a lot to the kinds of roles that he'd been playing for Wes Anderson. Here's the Colleen Kennedy Carpet passage that I promised before. Anderson's casting of Murray, though grounded in the actor's previous work, shows subtle yet significant modifications to his star persona that other directors have since adopted, and I think Sofia Coppola definitely among them. Anderson pushed Murray's persona to evolve beyond the high concept setups of Hollywood comedy to focus instead on quotidian struggles involving family, love, and finding one's place as an aging boomer in a changing world. So that suddenly gives a little bit more context to the kind of character that Steve Sisu is here in a way that wouldn't seem to fit Anderson's, you know, personality as a relatively young director at the, you know, with a burgeoning career. What convinced, I should point out that since that starting with Rushmore, Bill Murray has been involved in, I think, all of Wes Anderson's films. There might be one that he's not in. And that what drew him to working with Anderson in the first place was largely that he didn't feel like he needed to bring any comedy to the script. That the script for Rushmore was so tightly conceived, and I think he felt the same way about this role, that it wouldn't really require any comedic enhancement on his part. It's also largely Bill Murray who brings the deadpan aspect to Anderson's filmography, which we talked about at some length last time, which I think helps to anchor and at the same time add some levity to what otherwise might feel just a little bit too twee. It has, however, been pointed out, I don't know if I've got this, yes, that Bill Murray is also what keeps the film American, despite its setting and despite its European influences. Throughout the discussion of this film, Baumbach and Anderson go on and on about, especially European New Wave influences, Godard, among others, Fellini. There's a moment where Eric Romer comes up jokingly as a sort of excuse for why an aspect of the film isn't too tightly constructed, because they're drawing on that kind of structure that a Romer film would have. But there is definitely a sort of European Europhilia, let's say, at work in this film that Bill Murray, I think, kind of helps to ground. So this is what Kennedy Carpot has to say on that. The Mediterranean setting of Life Aquatic underscores the sensation that Murray is literally charting unfamiliar territory. Life Aquatic brought Wes Anderson's cast and crew out of, that should read America, I don't know where America is, but out of America for the first time, filming at Italy's legendary Cinecittà Studios. Producer Barry Mendel emphasizes how this location affected the process. Quote, there's something very Italian and European which has kind of crept into this film and made a unique fabric that wouldn't feel the same if it were made in America. That European flavor is actually a powerful, all sorts of typos here, a powerful force in the film. Yet this European veneer never subsumes Bill Murray's Americanness. There's a great interview that if you haven't seen with, what was the film, Monument Men, that Bill Murray did with Matt Damon and others. He has an interview with Graham Norton, the Irish, British talk show host. And it's just hilarious to see Bill Murray inserting himself into these situations. And the stories that they have of filming it, and Bill Murray just decides one day, you know, like, we're in Berlin, you know what? I've never been to Prague, and takes an overnight train and goes gets drunk in Prague and shows up the next day. But that Bill Murray's sort of insistent, grounded, unpretentious Americanness infuses this film. And that also connects to Zissou as a character who's surrounded by either, you know, foreign European or sort of actors, sometimes of marked ethnicity, from a host of different backgrounds, but still stays very American himself. Kennedy Carpot points out that Angelica Houston's character, we assume to be American, but seems very much at home wherever she is. You know, seems very worldly and cosmopolitan in a way that Steve Zissou just really doesn't. And that the only other sort of example of Americanness that we have in the film is Owen Wilson's character with his, you know, affected, genteel, not particularly convincing Southern drawl, but that he also has this sort of odd, you know, he's from Kentucky, he's from a region and not from a country, and at the same time he's an airplane pilot, so there's something sort of cosmopolitan about him. He's an airplane pilot who's now moneyed out of nowhere and can afford to bankroll this film. In that way, he's sort of cosmopolitan despite his situatedness. I think we can see this too in Bill Murray in the interviews that I was that I just showed you. There's a moment where he says, "What's that goofy city on the water?" Which is his way of referring to Naples, you know, one of the sort of capitals of European Italian culture. Naples, you know, rivals Rome in so many ways. And it's just for him, it's Naples is a goofy city on the water, I have to say. But, you know, it's that sort of goofy city on the water. I'll end with this note. One more thing, and then I'll end on the note of sort of family. There is a great, I'll put the link in the chat. Oopsies, didn't mean to do that. Hold on, I meant to copy, not click. There's a fun YouTube video. Oh, I've lost mine. Are you still seeing my, you know what, I can stop sharing. So this, that way I can find the chat. There's a great YouTube video that talks about all of the sort of stylistic features and visual features that make Wes Anderson look like Wes Anderson. And it points out, and I think I've linked directly to that moment, that on one of the DVD commentaries, there's a phone that rings in the background, and how this sort of contributes to Wes Anderson's a self-staging as an auteur, that there's an analog phone that's ringing in the background, that he can't be bothered to sort of pause the DVD commentary, you know, that he just goes and answers it and says like, "Sorry, I'll have to call you back." And that it sort of leaves him unpretentious and cutesy and all of these things. The DVD commentary for this film, for the Criterion Collection, it's Noah Baumbach and Wes Anderson sitting in a restaurant, and you can hear people being served, you can hear them talking, you hear dishes and glasses clatter in the background. And they end on this note a little bit prematurely, because then they realize there are a lot more credits to come and they're gonna have more to say. But they end with one of them saying, "I hope we don't sound too phony and pretentious here." And I think that in a way that's the role that Bill Murray is having, is bringing these high cultural references, but grounding them in a way that make them feel American and feel, you know, accessible to American audiences. And I think that has a lot to tell us about especially looking forward to the French Dispatch, about Anderson's prominence as a specifically American auteur. Thinking of Ned Plimpton, so Owen Wilson's character, I will just say one closing word on families, is that we tend to think of families in Wes Anderson as dysfunctional. That's obviously the focus of the Royal Tenenbaums, and here we have Steve Zissou, whose guiding statement is, "I hate fathers, and I never wanted to be one." At the same time, is a father figure. You know, this is the cult of celebrity that you have around somebody like Cousteau, who's sort of perpetually stalled in a kind of childhood, adopting a sort of father role at the end as he carries Vanna on his shoulders. But that, this film was very much made not only in collaboration with Noah Baumbach and with Owen Wilson and with Bill Murray and all the other actors whom form part of Anderson's stable, but also with Sui Jorge, who plays these David Bowie covers, translated into Brazilian Portuguese, oftentimes in ways that Wes Anderson's not fully aware of, So he's translating them to reflect on the film and to sort of make a commentary on the film. So if you speak Portuguese, apparently there's a whole other film there for you that's sort of being annotated by the way that these songs have been translated. But alongside saying that this is a film mostly about the pleasures and the joys and the luck of filmmaking and being able to do that as a career, it's also a film about elected families. The kind of family that we see Steve Sisu becoming the sort of, you know, father figure for, but also the kind of family that comes together in the making of a film. And I think that's one of the more beautiful aspects of this film. So thank you for being here to talk about this, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Ian. Yeah, as we move into the Q&A, I do encourage people to turn their cameras on just so we can see each other's faces. But yeah, now if you have any questions or comments, feel free to use that little raise hand feature, or you can just raise your hand and I will call on you. Anne.
Yeah, I really enjoyed Bill Murray in this movie more so than, I don't know, it's hard to say which one of my favorite Wes Anderson movies he's in. They're all so good. But it's interesting about the closeness in time, or actually filming at the same time, of Lost in Translation. I remember seeing Lost in Translation in the theater and people walking out. I, you know, you rarely see people walk out in the middle of a movie. And I think kind of like this movie, like, it needs to be appreciated. Lost in Translation is a fantastic movie, but, you know, that there's a commonness there, and also him playing a washed up has been in both of the movies as well. And I was really surprised. The first time I saw this movie, I didn't realize that Bud Cort was in it. And that really blew me away this time when I put it together and looked at the cast. I was like, oh my God, I can't believe that. So it's really also the first time I saw this movie, I think my kids were really young and I watched it at home and literally fell asleep. So this is the kind of movie you can fall asleep in, but I was glad I was up and watched it, you know, just the other day, and was like, wow, I missed the boat on this one.
It did take me a couple of times to get through it. I watched the first half and sort of paused. It's longer than I remember it being. I think the Lost in Translation parallel is really interesting, because that is, you can see why people would walk out of it. It feels like a film that's taking itself very seriously, where the slowness of it, the sort of understated quality of it, the kind of monotony, you know, there aren't a lot of sort of emotional highs or outbursts or, feel like someone is trying really hard. And with a legacy like Sofia Coppola has, you know, that really comes to the fore and can come across to audiences as pretentious. It's interesting that Bill Murray can incarnate, you know, can have sort of both of those functions, where he either adds to that element of a film, you know, why do you have this guy who doesn't even enunciate, you know, like a sort of rando, like, as the star of your film? You know, he's hardly a leading man. He's not good looking. He's not, you know. And then here ends up being the grounding element that sort of saves the film from being either too pretentious or too whimsical, you know, on the other end, that it could really just sort of venture into, what is all this stop motion animation? What are all these fantastic sea creatures? Why does that shark look so not like anything? What is the sort of flight of fancy that Wes Anderson is allowing himself as an auteur? And that it's really sort of brought back down by the presence of Bill Murray, and it makes it relatable. A lot of that, apparently Bill Murray was, you know, separated from his family as he was making this film for long stretches of time, because he's making these two films, you know, across the world from each other, and both, you know, very distant from where he lives at the same time. So I think that especially in, you know, the moments, the sort of dramatic moments of this film that have to do with family, there's an emotional depth there that one might not otherwise associate with Bill Murray. I think this is one of his best roles. I think this is I really like Bill Murray. I'm teaching Groundhog Day tomorrow in my Nietzsche class, so I've got Bill Murray on the brain. Groundhog Day and the Eternal Return. But he does have a sort of an emotional depth in this film that I think really makes it work.
Yeah, no, there's one other point. Other characters in the movie that were speaking about him in the beginning were saying, Eleanor runs the show. It doesn't work without her. And, you know, and that kind of unraveled and came to pass. And then she came back and he actually admits, you know, it doesn't work without her.
Yeah. It's a good moment in the movie where he says that. He sort of says that out of nowhere and, you know, it hardly even needs acknowledging. It's like, yeah, everybody knows, especially everyone here who's in this scene is, you know, part of the inner circle. Everyone is well aware. But he's saying that as part of his bid, you know, to become a father to Ned, it's that, you know, it's the mother here who's really calling the shot. She's the one who makes everything work. I think part of the reason too that Bill Murray is so endearing in this role is because it's so difficult to imagine him as the kind of character that one otherwise could see being played as Steve Zissou. You know, the sort of egomaniacal person who's so full of themselves and, you know, always wants to, make every cosmetic change to their public persona so that they can be heroic and all of these things. It's really hard to imagine Bill Murray in that role. And it's hard to imagine Bill Murray, you know, convincing as any sort of sea captain or a captain of a team or, you know, somebody who's going to be organized or, you know, calling the shots or literally, you know, even as a director. And so I think the clumsiness that he brings to that makes Steve Zissou into a really endearing figure. It takes a little bit of the edge off of that paterfamilias that we would see, say, in Gene Hackman's Royal Tenenbaum. But it just makes it all the more Wes Anderson that it can be that sweet, you know, and it doesn't need that edge to it.
There, well, has the unique ability, well, not unique, but you wouldn't expect him to be able to show vulnerability in a character the way he does, and more so in Lost in Translation, that character becomes very vulnerable. But I think that's part of his charm, in my opinion.
There's also from Rushmore through this film into Lost in Translation, there's a sort of theme of, you know, this aging man courting a younger woman, both here and in Rushmore. It's with this sort of son figure that there's a competition there. I don't remember that there's, there's her husband in Lost in Translation. It's been a decade at least since I've seen it, so I don't recall. But I don't know that there's the same sort of adopting the rival, but it's interesting that's the role that he's playing at this moment, is somebody who's realizing they're just a little bit too old for their love interest. And I love how just sort of explicitly that's put here. It's like, I'm sorry, have you not understood this yet? You're too old for me. Just sort of blunt. And he goes, yeah, yeah. I'm like, yes. How did you all feel about the ending of the film? How would you read that in terms of, is this just sort of stock footage that we've taken from Steve Zissou films that's being put there in the end? Or is it the suspension of the whole question of, you know, what is part of the filmic reality here? What is part of the diegesis and what is not? Interestingly, that moment, it's filmed on a jetty I couldn't quite catch it from the description, but it's apparently, it's just this, you know, sort of like boardwalk that's not connected to land anywhere. I don't know what it, you know, some sort of embankment problem, for, you know, flooding or something. But they saw it when they were filming and found it really curious and didn't know what to do like what it was there for. I thought we'd got to film something there, and it didn't really fit in anywhere. And so they decided to film it here at the end. It reminded them, I can't remember the film now, but it reminded them of something that Jeff Goldblum was in. And I said, oh, this film also ends that same way. And so I guess it's sort of an homage to that film. Although I think we decided, you know, we'd sort of map that out, that it was going to be set there before we managed to cast Jeff Goldblum. So here we have another sort of aspect of this cameo, you know, quasi cameo performances by this kind of actor.
I'll hop in and answer your question, Ian. So when I rewatched it, I just thought of that as like a very nice way to end the movie, you know, with the credits rolling and everything. I just thought it was like the ending sequence to the Life Aquatic that we were watching. But it was very interesting when you brought up to think of it as part of the documentary, because Ned is resurrected there. And he's not only resurrected, but he's back on the boom mic. So it's like kind of earlier Ned. So yeah. I definitely see an argument of it being part of the documentary.
Yeah. Interestingly, the guy who does the sound most, I noticed that this time watching, because I'd learned that, I can't remember, it's a Polish guy who does the sound that apparently he worked on every Wes Anderson film up at that point. I don't know if he continues to work on that. I can't remember his name, I'm afraid. But he both does the sound for the film and plays the boom guy in the film, which apparently causes some difficulties because he's got to get the sound right while at the same time, you know, looking the part and looking right in the film. And they make a big deal out of that. I mean, it's an interesting aspect. But so I was wondering why Owen Wilson would then be in that role in the end. It does seem to, you know, if we're you know, to use the technical term, trying to sort of parse what is diegetic, so what is part of the filmic universe here, that's an interesting moment because it takes that figure who is both non-diegetic, you know, like extra diegetic, part of the real world outside of the film, and also playing himself in the film, and then transports it onto a character who's, you know, for this purpose, has sort of been brought back to life. I also think it's sort of necessary to the film in that, you know, one of the places where it doesn't seem, where one could argue that it doesn't feel all that tightly constructed is the death of Owen Wilson. It is set up from the beginning. You kind of know they're never going to end up killing this jaguar shark, but just wouldn't be in keeping. Owen Wilson is nearly killed off the first adventure that he goes on, and then does get killed off later. So it's coming, you know, it's the Chekhovian gun that needs to get fired, but it feels like a device. And I think Bill Murray's delivery and also just the way that it's edited together, where you have this sort of oddly undramatic helicopter crash. There's also a helicopter crash involved in the making of the film. And then he sort of carries his body to shore and then it's just sort of over. It doesn't have the function that the death, especially of a son, you know, this is a trope in films, and it generally grounds the sort of emotional weight of the film. You can think of something like In the Bedroom or All About My Mother, Pedro Almodovar, starts with the death of a son. It's also a trope in propaganda films, whatever. It doesn't have any of those functions here, and it for that reason feels almost a little bit gratuitous. So I think we need that ending where he comes back and where he's there, and so that we can just sort of enjoy existing in the filmic world as it is, where no one ever goes lost. You can watch this film 1,000 times and come back to it, and all the characters will still be there, and none of their struggles are really all that real. You know, Bill Murray and Jeff Goldblum are going to make up in the end. Bill Murray and Angelica Houston are going to make up in the end. None of the conflict really feels like it's really that threatening. And I think it's important for that reason that Owen Wilson's character, well, I don't know if Owen Wilson's character, but that Owen Wilson can be there at the end for the curtain call in a way so that you don't feel like he's gone lost. Otherwise, this would be a tragedy. And it's not, it's a comedy.
Virginia?
I just have a question, because this is the first time that I've seen the film. Many of you have seen it several times, apparently. I thoroughly enjoyed it. When the film came out the first time and was received poorly, what were the maybe two or three key features that they focused on that they people didn't like or the critics didn't like?
They thought it was unrealistic. They thought it was just a bit too twee. You know, it was a bit too fanciful. It was a bit too Wes Anderson. They thought that it was Wes Anderson. I think in a way it's inevitable that the film that comes after a film like The Royal Tenenbaums is always going to be panned. You know, reading between the lines a little bit, I think on the one hand, it got taken to task for the ways in which it wasn't like The Royal Tenenbaums. You know, why is this suddenly, why are we crossing an ocean? Why are in the Mediterranean? Why are there these weird special effects which don't look like special effects? Why is it an adventure thing? What is Jacques Cousteau doing in there? Like, you're supposed to do family dramas set in a sort of J.D. Salinger, you know, upper class New York. Stick to it. So on the one hand, there's that. It's too different from The Royal Tenenbaums. On the other hand, what bothers people is that it's too much like Wes Anderson. And that what stuck was not the themes, although the, you know, the theme of family, of parentage, of adoption, you know, all of these things are in there. But that it's strayed too far from the sort of, you know, plot and thematic content of The Royal Tenenbaums while still sticking to a very Wes Anderson style. And so I think that it did. It sort of got charged with trying too hard, spending too much money to sort of establish Wes Anderson as somebody who can do, you know, anything without breaking out of a Wes Anderson mold, so that, you know, the charge of self-parody. The charge of self-parody is always a really damning one, because it implies that you're two-dimensional, that there's not a lot of depth there. And I think that was sort of what the reception of the film looked like. I'm trying to remember, there was one study that looked specifically at reviews, I think, of this film, and it sort of mapped the use of the term deadpan or other synonyms, and that became a problem. That sort of Bill Murray's deadpan expression, the thing we were talking about in Lost in Translation, was a sort of turnoff for certain audiences, or for audiences, you know, critical audiences expecting a certain thing out of Wes Anderson. I'm seeing a question here. I've missed some of this, so please forgive me if this has been asked. How do you feel about the Bowie covers as the soundtrack, and how does it add to the film for you? Without being an enormous fan of Bowie, just because I feel like I have to have that caveat, because Bowie fans, including some of my nearest and dearest, are so rabid that I want to make sure that I'm not claiming deep knowledge of Bowie's discography. I love Bowie, and I love, and I really like the songs chosen here. I like the songs chosen here as songs. I think in a lot of ways they're weird. One thing that it does, especially the ending with Queen Bitch, which is, Wes Anderson says he thinks it's about Lou Reed. I also think it might be about Lou Reed, but it's about homosexual desire in any way, in any event. It helps tamper Steve Zissou's homophobia and makes it into something that really is just a concern about the plot. It makes it something that, you know, Wes Anderson as a filmmaker is critiquing, so that, you know, we're not just sort of being asked to laugh along as he's calling people bullites, you know, and fags or whatever. But you can see that the film is situating itself differently toward that. I think the sort of imaginative, playful aspect of Bowie, the sort of self-creation that Bowie has, is important there. I was mentioning earlier, I don't know if you were here for this, but the Soy Jorge translations of the Bowie songs apparently are in most cases not particularly literal. Rebel, 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 for instance, doesn't actually make it into the Portuguese at any point. And Wes Anderson said, you know, you might want to put that in there. And so it got added into another song at another stage. But that apparently there's a through line in which the, and I could, if you'd like, you can send me an email, put my email in here, and I can send you an article on that. But apparently there are certain moments where the translations of the songs are actually commenting on what's going on on the film in ways that Wes Anderson isn't entirely aware of. So there's a sort of shared authorship there, which I think is reflected in the fact that, you know, we return to Soy Jorge at the end, and we just you know, see him in front of this dramatic backdrop, just sort of sitting and playing. And that's a moment where Wes Anderson on the commentary says, you know, I think some people might not like this. Like, what, didn't he have a story to tell? Why is he returning this? Oh my God, we've got to hear another Bowie song. But I just think it sort of works well. And in a way, it kind of carries the film. It sets the mood for the film. There are also interesting ways in which those songs interact, the sort of covers of the songs that are mostly diegetics or within the filmic universe get then rehashed in an extra diegetic way. For instance, I think when we're taking the tour of the boat in cross section, it's a Bowie song playing. We have a lot of sort of Bowie songs playing over the kind of trademark Wes Anderson moments that are happening. It's not just Wes Anderson, but you know, that are happening in slow motion with a sort of emotional soundtrack behind them. The Bowie or the music that's being piped into their earpieces as they're diving and becomes what's the word I'm looking for? Indistinguishable at moments from the soundtrack itself. So it's again, you know, one of these aspects where it's hard to tell what's part of the film's plot and what's just part of the overall aesthetic experience. So I like all of that. I think Life on Mars is paradigmatic in that sense. The final song, ending with Queen Bitch, I'm not sure. A lot of it is sort of mysterious to me, but it ends up being both about the lyrics or about, you know, whatever the content of these songs are as Wes Anderson receives them, and not being about that, because that's not how they come across apparently in the translations that they're given. Yeah, my pleasure. Send me an email if you'd like, and I will forward you the article that talks about that.
I have a question for you, Ian, which we can probably end on, just looking at the time. So you mentioned Noah Baumbach and Wes and their relationship throughout, and I was wondering if you could talk more about that. I know that they also co-wrote Fantastic Mr. Fox, and I think Wes was a producer for maybe one or two of Baumbach's films, but I don't really know too much about their relationship, just beyond like very basic facts.
I don't know either, and I expected it to sort of, especially given the prominence that Noah Baumbach has these days, I expected it to be a sort of through line in the scholarship, or, you know, just like, you know, writing on this film. It was mentioned somewhere that the extent of Baumbach's influence on this was difficult to determine. But then there's not a footnote, there's not anything that helps me sort of figure out what that means, other than I don't know, and apparently this person is not going to tell me. I didn't see it remarked upon a lot. There is somewhere somebody wrote about the sort of dysfunctional family dynamics that you could compare across Wes Anderson's work and then into Baumbach's. It's interesting, you know. Baumbach is a much less playful director. I like Noah Baumbach, but. It's not the same sensibility as Wes Anderson. And I've always found it, I think they're very close friends. They seem to be, or I've heard that at least. I find it an interesting pairing, honestly. But yeah, so I don't know how much he had to do with this, especially as I said, since Wes Anderson started writing this in college. And it was really Owen Wilson who was goading him on to, you know, turn it into a film. I'm not sure at what stage Baumbach came into the process, or, you know, what he had to do with it. He does have a cameo at one point. He plays the assistant to the producer, and so he's standing in the background somewhere. So he is in the film. He leaves his fingerprints on it as well.
I like that. That's a good Easter egg for all of us the next time we watch it. But thank you so much for all that you shared tonight, Ian. So much new information, new ways to look at The Life Aquatic, Bill Murray's involvement, and just you know, Wes in general, how this was perceived. So thank you everybody for coming, but thank you especially Ian for leading the event this evening.
Thank you everybody, it was my pleasure. And I wish you all the best of luck with the future film series. This one was great.
Thank you. Bye everybody.